Okay, for learning objective three, we're going to discuss the significance of Jefferson's and Madison's presidencies and show how they helped lead to the downfall of the Federalist Party and led to what is called the development of the era of good feeling, which is just a flowery way of describing the time period between 1816 and 1824, when there was just one party rule, when it was just the Democratic Republicans controlling all levers of the federal government. So, starting with Jefferson, we've got these three examples that demonstrate his ability to basically take hold of Federalist ideas in the name of pragmatism, basically doing what works. And in doing so, basically taking Federalist ideas, that is Hamiltonian ideas about what the federal government could and should not do, he was able to undermine the Federalist Party. And Madison, I'll talk about in a little bit, is going to do the same. And this is going to isolate the Federalist Party. And by 1816, it's not going to be a political party anymore. So let's start with the Tripleton War of 1801 to 1805, sometimes referred to as the Barbarian Wars. And to do that, we'll watch a short video clip.
Pirates stalked the seas again, seizing ships and holding cargoes and crews hostage. Strange as it seems, the U.S. Navy and Marine Corps were forged over two centuries ago to fight pirates. For hundreds of years, the Barbary pirates, or corsairs, terrorized the Mediterranean Sea. They sailed from ports along the North African coast, taking their name from the Barbary states of Tripoli, Tunis, Algiers, and Morocco. The Muslim pirates sided with the Ottoman Turks against Christian Europe. They preyed on merchant vessels, attacking ships and imprisoning their crews. If no one ransomed captive sailors, the corsairs enslaved them at hard labor. Barbary pirates raided as far away as England and Iceland, kidnapping villagers to sell in African and Ottoman slave markets. Sometimes European governments fought the pirates. More often, they paid them bribes, called tribute, to leave their ships alone. But across the Atlantic, a new nation was forming that would challenge the Barbary corsairs. After Americans threw off British rule, the merchant ships no longer had Royal Navy protection. The corsairs began to prey on American vessels bound for Mediterranean ports. For the new nation to survive, its goods had to reach market. The U.S. had to protect its commercial fleet. Fresh from British occupation, Americans distrusted the idea of a national military. Many of the founding fathers wanted a navy only strong enough to protect American shores. With few warships, the U.S. simply couldn't fight the pirates. In 1784, Congress agreed to spend $80,000 to bribe the Barbary corsairs. To make the deal, Thomas Jefferson and John Adams sailed to England. In London, the envoys asked Tripoli's ambassador what gave the Barbary states the right to seize American ships and crews. It was the duty of all believers to make war against the unbelievers, the ambassador replied. Any Muslim slain in battle was sure to go to paradise. But he promised them that payments to Tripoli would guarantee safe passage. So America, too, paid tribute. The corsairs released American captives and agreed to let American ships be. But the attacks continued. As Americans began to lose patience, their leaders debated what to do. Jefferson argued for a stronger navy. It will be more easy to raise ships and men to fight these pirates and to reason, he wrote. than money to bribe them. John Adams disagreed. "We ought not fight them at all," he said, "unless we determine to fight them forever." America resisted a military buildup until bribes to the pirates grew to almost 20% of the national budget. And still American sailors suffered in Barbary prisons. The country's outlook hardened. Congress decided America needed a force that could defend its trade on the world's oceans. In 1794, President George Washington authorized construction of 6 frigates, long-range attack vessels, fast and well-armed. Each would carry U.S. Marines, a force modeled on British troops stationed aboard warships. Now America would have a fighting navy. In 1801, Jefferson became president. Tripoli immediately tested him. Its ruler, Pasha Yusuf Karamanli, demanded more tribute. When Jefferson refused, the Pasha declared war. Only Congress could send Americans into combat. But on his own, President Jefferson ordered U.S. warships to the Mediterranean. After the frigate sailed, he revealed what he'd done. "The style of the demand admitted but one answer," Jefferson told Congress. "I sent a small squadron of frigates into the Mediterranean." At first, the U.S. Navy fared badly. Corsairs took the USS Philadelphia, imprisoning her crew and sailing the captured frigate to Tripoli. At home, critics savaged Jefferson's foreign adventure. He stayed the course. A turning point came in 1804. In a night raid led by Lieutenant Stephen Decatur, Navy commandos blew up Philadelphia. U.S. warships bombarded Tripoli, wrecking her fortifications. Still, Karamanli refused to release his American captives. After a year of fruitless negotiation, the U.S. took action again. William Eaton, American consul to Tunis, assembled a small force of Marines and mercenaries. In April 1805, Eaton marched his troops from Egypt across 500 miles of desert to catch the Pasha by surprise. The Marines recruited the Pasha's enemies, including his brother, then invaded Tripoli. To stay in power, Pasha Yusuf signed a treaty releasing American hostages and promising to end attacks on American ships. The hard line seemed to work. Jefferson told Congress, "The states on the Barbary Coast seem generally disposed at present to respect our peace and friendship." But the Corsairs had not ended their attacks. And in 1815, Commodore Stephen Decatur led American fighting men to victory in a second war against the Barbary pirates. This time, the raids stopped for good. The pirate kingdoms were beaten, and a new maritime power had emerged. President James Madison declared, "As peace is better than war, war is better than tribute. The United States, while they wish for war with no nation, will buy peace with none."
So with the Barbary Wars of 1801 to 1805, or the Tripolitan War, we see Jefferson exerting a great deal of power here, which he would have been formally against, in sending the Navy and the Marines without congressional approval ahead of time. So he's taking from Federalist ideas that in order for the United States to be functional, it needs a strong central government. This is definitely a sign of a strong central government that sets a precedent for future presidents to exercise such power. Now, with the Louisiana Purchase, we went over the details of that in the last lecture, but this is just another example of him instilling the levers of power of the federal government to do something like purchase huge tracts of land. And again, he's doing this pragmatically. He sees a greater benefit for the United States by ignoring his one-time conviction of having a strict interpretation of the Constitution. And with the Embargo Act of 1807, this is another example of him exercising strong authority within the federal government, abandoning his once anti-federalist ideas. Let's take a look at a clip to understand the details of the Embargo Act.
Meanwhile, the Napoleonic Wars begin to interfere with America's expanding shipping industry.
It was a lose-lose situation of how to negotiate the troubled waters in the Napoleonic Wars. It's important to keep in mind that the Jeffersonians, as much as the Federalists, were determined to maintain neutrality. So the dilemma for Jefferson is that belligerent talk and the effort to vindicate neutral rights went for him hand in hand with a failure to prepare.
In the interim, what Jefferson sought to do was to impose an embargo. And that put the Customs Service in a very difficult position because, of course, they saw themselves as developing and articulating what this commercial republic was and how it ought to develop further and prosper. And yet here was Thomas Jefferson saying we had to put essentially restrictions on that by imposing an embargo.
The embargo triggers a serious economic depression. Hardest hit are the merchants and shipowners of the Northeast, most of them Federalists.
It's one of the great tragic set pieces of American political history. It led Jefferson into wholesale invasions of civil rights and liberties, trying to keep Americans from trading abroad. It was logistically impossible and required the use of federal power in the court systems in a way that was effectively nullified throughout much of New England. In fact, Jefferson's reverence or respect for local self-government was reinforced by New England's resistance to his embargo. But of course, the ultimate disaster was that that war came nonetheless. It was called Mr. Madison's War, but it was really Mr. Jefferson's War.
So what we're seeing with the Embargo Act is Jefferson using the Article 1, Section 8, Clause 3. He's interpreting this part of the Constitution very loosely. So reading it, it reads pretty straightforward: to regulate commerce with foreign nations and among the several states and with the Indian tribes, right? So the word that's being loosely interpreted here is regulate, right? It doesn't say eliminate trade, it says regulate trade. But he's trying to keep the United States out of a war that he believes that cannot be won at this point, and he's thinking that if we cut off trade, this will be a more effective lever against Great Britain. It'll be a more pragmatic use of power rather than going to a war in which we will probably lose. And so this is again Jefferson exercising what he would have perceived prior to being president, a Federalist interpretation of the role of the federal government, that is, using a loose interpretation of the Constitution to evoke more power as an executive. For Madison, I'm going to go into a little bit more detail about the Second Bank of the United States in 1816 in the next learning objective, But the point here is that he does issue it, and this is something that would have went against his political principles. At first, he believes that this bank represents a overreach of the federal government, but the circumstances of the economy are going to make it necessary to create a bank, and so he's going to be pragmatic and lead the legislation to form the Second Bank of the United States in 1816. As President of the United States. Once again, another Democratic Republican borrowing from Federalist ideas and undermining the Federalist Party. And so by the time we get to 1816, the Federalist Party is basically a dismantled party. And so from this time period here, 1816 to 1824, the only political party operating the levers of power in the federal government is essentially the Democratic Republican Party. And we will touch in the next learning objective how that begins to change with the rise of Jacksonian democracy.